Though I think he visited Syracuse before. He made very important contributions in the initial stages of the rigorous mathematical formulation of loop quantum gravity. There is this very famous paper under the acronym ALM squared T, and he was one of the M's. So he has a very, very strong mathematical background, deep knowledge of mathematics, and today he will be talking about quantization. So the title of his talk is Non-Uniqueness of Quantization, Keeler Geometry, and Generalized Coherent State Transform. So please.
Thank you very much, Fernando. So I thank the organizers. I'm very honored to be here in this conference in honor of my dear friend, Jurek Lewandowski. So we met in, as Fernando said, in 93. Jurek was, I must say, at the beginning a bit upset that a Portuguese guy studied in Moscow. but then I explained him, you know, we just had come out before I went to Moscow. Portugal had 50 years of fascism, and so, and after that, Soviet Union started giving 50 fellowships every year. So I took one of them and studied physics in Moscow State University. So I think Jurek accepted that, and then we became very good friends. So this was in Syracuse. I was there for a short visit. Then I went, I had a very special year, a sabbatical year in Penn State, where there was this fantastic scientific atmosphere, thanks to Abai. It was a fantastic year there. So then we had this collaboration, LMMT. L was not there most of the time. But then we had these meetings, very nice meetings, AMMT, the four of us, and we would get, you know, solve problems and get progress, but then we would also frequently, of course, get stuck. And then we would phone L, Jurek. And very often, Jurek would, maybe not immediately, but next morning would, you know, call us and tell us what was the way out. So it was a fantastic collaboration. So it went for several years. And after that, I've been trying, not always very successful, to get to the to keep up to the scientific standards of that collaboration. So the message is, I will try to convey here, are basically first that the space of quantum theories includes an infinite dimensional space, which is the space of possible choices of maximal local abelian algebras of observables. We call these preferred observables, and these are the observables that we lack diagonally, so we will have a Hilbert space of functions of those observables. But the message here will be that one should expect most of these choices to lead to non-equivalent quantizations. And this is true for systems with finite number of degrees of freedom. This is true for the particle in the line. So we always have this infinite dimensional space of quantizations. And I will take this space of quantizations to be space of choices of these abelian algebras of observables. And so we'll have this very complicated space that I will represent by.
Do you need?
Yes, please. Okay. Just a little bit. Yeah. Maybe you can keep it like this.
Okay.
Is it okay? You can see it? No? Ah, okay. So I'll just. So if you think of these as spaces of quantizations made by choosing real observables, then we have this disconnected, very complicated, infinite dimensional manifold. For instance, if we are, our system is that of a particle on the circle, so that the phase space is the cotangent bundle of S1, just a cylinder. So choosing the Schrödinger quantization means that we choose these vertical polarization functions of theta. Then choosing the momentum representation will correspond to having just functions of P, and we have this vertical polarization, which is, of course, topologically different in a different component than the vertical one. So maybe surprisingly, by allowing these special algebras to consist also of complex observables, the situation becomes much nicer. We get an open convex subset in a vector space, the space of Keller structures. This is for compact manifolds, but for non-compact, the situation is very similar. So this is just the space of Keller polarizations. Is an open subset, can be considered as an open subset in the space of functions on the manifold. So topologically it's very simple, but it has a very rich geometry because it's it has the Mabuki metric, which gives it the structure of a space with a constant curvature. And we will see that geodesics are in this space will be important for us to study different quantizations, and different quantizations are different choices in this. So,
what is M and what is that space?
So M is the symplectic manifold. So our system is a symplectic manifold. So M with a symplectic form. And then this is the space of quantizations on M, which can be related with the space of Keller structures on M. And you can think of Keller structures parameterized by potentials, and potentials are functions on M. Okay.
So that example strictly does not belong to this class because it is non.
Exactly. Very good. So they live on the boundary. So one of the things that this will allow us to do is to connect quantizations that are inside the space, but also quantizations that are on different connected components of the boundary, and this will be of interest also. So, So one thing we will be studying this. So we'll be studying these choices of maximal abelian subalgebras. By choosing that, we choose our Hilbert space, and these functions of these special observables will act diagonally. Now we will see that if these functions are complex valued, and if they define a Keller polarization, then we have many things. I will give details in some examples. So we can construct quantization, and we can compare different quantizations by using the geometry in the space of quantizations. So the first In the first part, we will discuss these different quantizations. And in the second part, we will compare different quantizations by using the so-called generalized coherent state transforms that make the lift of geodesics in the space of Keller structures to the quantum bundle above it. So, so with more than 100 years of general relativity and 90 years of quantum mechanics, it's becoming increasingly embarrassing the fact that we don't have a fully consistent theory of quantum gravity. Of course, there are very good candidates. Loop quantum gravity has done huge advances. But I think that we would all agree that there are still some issues to be faced. And I will be concentrating on the issue of non-uniqueness of quantization by choosing different preferred observables. Now, maybe one element to relieve us from this embarrassment is that the problems of quantum field theory are becoming more and more widely accepted. And for instance, for the first time this year, a huge ERC grant, the synergy grants involve 10 million euros. And the first grant given to mass physics, it was given to this, so synergy grant is given to 4 or 5 PIs. And it was given to Anderson, Einhard, Koncevich, and Marino. Koncevich is Fields Medal. And what they are doing is to define new quantum theory. And what they are basing, they are using this theory in analysis called resurgent analysis, invented by Akal some years ago. And they are using it to reinterpret asymptotic series by extracting from this asymptotic series the non-perturbative corrections that they need to get a convergent series. So this is around these and around mirror symmetries. So this, they are finding new elements and redefining quantization of even finite dimensional systems also. So, of course, we all know that the dream of the founders of quantum mechanics was to have a well-defined process to quantize a classical system. So you have a classical system, meaning a symplectic manifold. From it, you get a quantum system. And this was soon realized never to be possible. So in mathematics, one will say that there is not such a thing like a quantization functor. Now, just to set notation, to set up some notation, let me go to the particle on the line. So our symplectic manifold is R2 with the standard symplectic form. And if we take the usual particle in a potential, then the Hamiltonian vector field is given by this, and its flow corresponds to the Hamiltonian equations. Now, Schrödinger quantization means that we choose as preferred observables Q and functions of Q. This gives us, as Hilbert spaced, functions of Q, square integrable. Q acts diagonally, and P acts like this. Now, of course, after we choose this is the big ambiguity in quantization, is choose maximal abelian subalgebra. After that, of course, we still have a factor order ambiguities for some observables, not for others. And so, as I said, we have this no-go theorem that is never possible to fulfill Dirac's dream of getting this, of getting a self-adjoint operators representing real-valued functions, satisfying the commutation relations, and plus some additional natural requirements like irreducibility. So this is never possible. So what we do is we need to add additional data. And this is additional data that, in our case, will be this choice of maximal abelian subalgebra. So in general, for the particle in the line, we just choose, of course, we have preferred observables. We have Q and P, and they form this Heisenberg algebra. We take its complexification, and then there is a unique unitary representation, and that all fits very well in the quantization of the particle in the real line. Now, let us go to more complicated systems and describe briefly what geometric quantization tells us to do. Geometric quantization is perhaps the best way of quantizing a system mathematically. So we start with the classical data, is the manifold with the symplectic form. We will need it to quantize that it satisfies some integrality conditions. If this is satisfied, then we have to add some mild data, finite dimensional data, which is we choose a line bundle over the symplectic manifold with the curvature such that with the connection delta nabla such that the curvature is proportional to the symplectic form. Okay? Then our pre-quantum Hilbert space will be sections, which is just some twisted functions, sections of that line bundle. So twisted functions on the symplectic manifold, and we get this L2 space of functions. This almost fulfills Dirac's dream, because we satisfy this. We satisfy exactly this property. But unfortunately, this space is too big, okay? So the representation is not irreducible. And we need to impose a way to go to subspaces. And our way of going to subspaces is choosing this maximal subalgebra of maximal abelian local subalgebra. So if your phase space is S2, and you want to have a Keller polarization there, this subalgebra will have to be local. It will be generated by holomorphic functions that will not exist globally except for the constant one. So we have to choose, if we are with 1 degree of freedom, the only thing we have to choose is a function. To choose a function that generates the maximal abelian subalgebra, and then the wave functions will be functions of this function times some factor. If this function is complex valued, and if this defines the Keller polarization, then everything is very well defined. We will have no problems with reality conditions because we get the honest subspace of the pre-quantum Hilbert space. And the inner product is well defined. Everything, just we need to choose a complex valued function that in 1 degree of freedom, the only property it has to have is that df, which df bar is different from zero at every point. If that holds, then you have a unique complex structure and the Keller structure that, and the complex structure is such that for which this f is a local holomorphic coordinate. Okay? So let me, are all these quantizations equivalent? Let me show that they are not in a very simple example. So Let us consider the one-parameter family of anharmonic oscillators. And we will consider, for every fixed lambda, two quantizations of this system, which will give different spectra for the same observable. So the first quantization that we consider of H lambda is that of the Schrödinger quantization, in which Q acts diagonally. So it acts like this. And then we know how P acts. So we have this operator. And then we have the spectral analysis giving, not exactly, but perturbatively, the spectrum of this observable. Now, let us consider one parameter family of quantizations, each of them based on H lambda. So we have this. Now, we want what is called the energy quantization of H lambda, so that the wave functions will be functions of H lambda. And if we do that, we go to geometric quantization. We see that the wave functions are functions of H lambda plus some common phase factor. But then geometric quantization tells you that if your the leaves where these preferred observables are constant, the level sets of these preferred observables, if they have non-trivial H1, if they have non-contractible cycles, then you have some what are called Bohr-Sommerfeld quantization conditions, which are, of course, just the same that Bohr-Sommerfeld came up with in the first days of quantum mechanics. So the Hilbert space in that case will be of linear combinations of delta functions supported on these so-called semi-classical spectrum of the anharmonic oscillators. So you just take the closed curves corresponding to classical trajectories that have inside an area which is h bar times n plus 1 half if you put the Maslow correction, the alpha correction. So of course, if we have the lambda equals 0, this is the harmonic oscillator, then these two spectra coincide. On the other hand, if lambda is positive, then we'll get different spectra. For the energy representation, we get the Bohr-Sommerfeld semi-classical spectrum will be the exact spectrum of H lambda, while for the Schrödinger representation, we know that the exact spectrum is not equal to the Bohr-Sommerfeld. Of course, for a particle on the line, we can say that there is a preferred observable, and this preferred observable is Q and P. And of course, if we have this difference in quantizations, then in this case wins the Schrödinger quantization and not the energy quantization.
Is your point of view? I thought your point of view is that once you have pre-quantization, then given any observable, I've got a pre-quantum observable, so I don't have any choice. But once you use a polarization, this polarization will not be left invalid.
Exactly.
And so then there's a choice. And then there's fact, and that we just smuggle into factor ordering, for example.
Yes.
So I could choose a factor ordering such that the two spectra are the same.
Well, in this case, of course, you can always change. In this case, you don't have factor ordering in the Schrödinger representation because you have a function of P plus a function of Q. And in the energy representation, there is no question of having factor ordering because it acts diagonally. So the spectrum is just the values where it is supporting the function.
I see. So energy so representation preserves the polarization.
Exactly.
I see.
So when you talk about the quantization, you probably
That would be where the factor ordering was.
So if you are in, with a Keller polarization, then you are in better shape than you are in the real polarization. Because suppose you have this even degree of freedom, you have this, sorry, yeah. So you have this function, f. If it's complex value, f acts as a multiplication by f. Transforms holomorphic sections to holomorphic sections. Now, f, the f bar acts as f Hermitian conjugate. Of course, you may be interested in the real part of f or on the imaginary part of f. Okay? Then it's fine. You just use this f and f bar. Or you may be interested on a more complicated function of these, and then you have factor ordering between these. But this, everything is up to factor ordering. Everything is totally defined by it. So, so of course, in quantum gravity, we have also the Asker-Carbajal connection, and we have the question of the value of beta. So, we have real polarizations that lie on the boundary of the space of Keller polarizations. So, some recent works point again to the beta equal to I, which corresponds to the Asker-Carbajal connection. And as I said before, in fact, choosing complex observables is, from the point of view of the quantum theory, better than choosing real observables, because the, just the Hilbert space, if this defines a Keller structure, and whether it defines or not, it's just we have to compute the complex structure associated, and then with the symplectic form, we just check whether the metric is positive definite or not. So let me give a quick example. When did we start?
Five past.
Yes. So let us go back to one day of three. Suppose you like as preferred observable Q plus IFP. It could be Q plus IP, and then you you like the Fock representation. But you might like exponent of P. Then, well, the only thing you need for the conditions I mentioned is that the derivative of F is positive everywhere. Okay? So then, you have a totally well-defined quantum theory. Let me show here how we rescued by the power of complex analysis and complex geometry. So from this function, Q plus IFP, I get everything. I get the complex structure, the unique complex structure for which that ZF is a global holomorphic coordinate. I get the Keller metric. I get the scalar curve. Okay, just this. Then I want to get the Hilbert space. Hilbert space is given by holomorphic functions of ZF. Exponent minus the Keller potential. What is the Keller potential? You just take the Legendre transform of the primitive of F, and that's it, that's the Keller potential. And then you have your product, so you can quantize this function as a multiplication operator, but you may be, of course, interested on Q or on P, and then you just do the quantization of Z bar and so on. Okay, so so this was the first part. I tried to put emphasis on the importance Keller polarizations and Keller geometry as in defining quantization of a classical system. Now, some applications of these and of the very rich geometry that there is in the space of Keller polarizations. So first, this was studied by people in Keller geometry. So there is these applications to the Donaldson-Tien theory of stability of Keller manifolds. Then, using imaginary time canonical transformations, we can find new solutions to the geodesic equation of the space of Keller metrics. This is a nonlinear PDE of Monge-Ampère type. It's called complex homogeneous Monge-Ampère equation. So we can just, by turning time to imaginary, find new solutions to, the, to this nonlinear PDE. So it helps in quantization because this will be the point I'll be describing now. It helps to build coherent state transforms to compare different choices of preferred observables, different quantizations. Now, it has been applied to study quantum physics of open systems in which you have a system which is not closed, so you don't have energy conservation. You may try to model that with a complex value of the Hamiltonian, and then you may want to study semi-classical approximation for complex Hamiltonians, and again, if you do that, you get these geodesic equations of the space of Keller metrics. So we have been trying to apply this to quantum OPs by studying the geometry dependence of fractional quantum Hall trial states, these Laughlin states for quantum Hall physics, on curved surfaces. So they are defined for flat surfaces, and we see how they change when you bend the surface. And also in representation theory, algebraic geometry and quantization. So this is the last topic, is the one we are working now. What we do here is precisely, for instance, in the case of the phase space being the cotangent bundle of SU2, which is relevant in loop quantum gravity, if you want to define what is the momentum representation, so the usual momentum representation is not well defined. You cannot just take the electric fields constant because they don't commute with each other. So you have a different way of doing that. So what you have to do is to float. Okay, thank you. You have to take the free particle and take the usual Keller polarization, the usual Fock representation for SL2C, and then take the free particle Hamiltonian and flow in imaginary time to infinite imaginary time. If you do that, you get to this momentum representation that is momentum in the usual sense that is built from the electric field and the components commute to each other. These coherent state transforms are built in two steps. Suppose you have two choices of maximal subalgebras of commuting observables. So then the hope is to link them. So if they are Keller, then you know they live in an infinite dimensional Riemannian manifold, and there are existence theorems for geodesics connecting these two. What this means is that there exists an Hamiltonian such that by flowing in imaginary time from F1 to F2, from F1 you get to F2. There will be a geodesic connecting these two. And then if we find this geodesic, if we find this Hamiltonian that takes us from F1 to F2, we just have the standard methods of geometric quantization to lift this geodesic to the quantum bundle and construct a coherent state transform that will do this job. Let me go and end by explaining this reinterpretation of all coherent state transform from the point of view of geometric quantization. So in 94, during this year that we spoke before, Brian Old constructed a very nice unitary map from L2 on the compact Lie group G to holomorphic L2 functions on GC. This is a very nice transform, but quite mysterious, because you just transform L2 functions into real analytic by solving the ETH equation in the initial condition of the L2 function, and then you analytically continue the result to the complexified group. It's nice, but it's a bit mysterious that it's unitary. And in fact, there is a very simple representation theoretic argument before behind this. And this is, let's see this on the level of particle on the line for the compact group is similar, even though there is one piece that is less compelling. But so suppose you have old transform which corresponds to the Siegel-Bargmann transform from the Schrödinger representation to the Fock representation, then by this. So what you do is you solve the ETH equation and then you analytically continue. Now by representing in this way, we already see the relation of these two factors. Neither of them is unitary. The composition is unitary. So what you see is that here you are solving the Schrödinger equation in time minus I, while by doing this, Q plus IP, you are solving the classical equation for the same Hamiltonian in time I. So comparing these operators, you'll see that the strange all composition, in fact, corresponds to this. You first evolve in time minus I with respect to the Schrödinger operator representing your fixed H complexifier. And then you follow with the pre-quantum Hilbert space. Now this operator here, corresponding to the analytic continuation, is what takes you from the Schrödinger representation, functions of Q to functions of Z. So changes the representation, this one. But when it changes the representation, it is not intertwining representations of the algebra. And so what happens here is that you see that in order to intertwine the representations of the Weyl algebra that you have on the Schrödinger and on the Fock representation, you have to compose these two factors. Okay? So maybe I end here. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much. So we have some time for questions or comments. Anyone? Abai?
Very, very interesting, but there are basic things that I want to make sure I understood. So the first thing is that the space of Kähler structures, as you said, you know, you give me any function satisfying some mild condition, and then you get a Kähler. And therefore, it's an infinite dimensional space. But you're talking about geodesics on that. So you're saying that it is actually, is it a Hilbert manifold? What kind of manifold is it?
It's a weakly Riemannian manifold. It's not Hilbert. It's usually considered modeled on C infinity. So it's like a Fréchet manifold.
Uh-huh.
But from the point of view of topology, it's an open subset of C infinity of M.
I see. Right?
So topologically is not very interesting, but the geometry is very nice because it can be realized exactly as the limit of GLM over UM as n goes to infinity, and this limit depends on the manifold, of course, you have, but is very precise for compact manifolds, is given very precise in this scalar geometry.
But okay, so I mean, I asked you before about this. Most of physics doesn't do with compact manifold. Phase spaces that we consider with are non-compact. Right.
So in the non-compact manifold, we still have geodesic equations. The metric is not very well defined because in the tangent space we'll have a vector with infinite norm and so on. But the geodesic equations, you just try the same ones that hold in the compact cases, and they correspond to geodesic equations. They are solved by imaginary time canonical transformation. So you just do this imaginary time canonical transformation. When you do that, you are in fact defining the diffeomorphism on the complexification of your phase space, but then there is a canonical way of projecting this back and defining the honest diffeomorphism on your manifold. And this is what I call imaginary time canonical transformations, like diffeomorphisms, which are not canonical, they don't preserve the symplectic form, but they correspond, they generate geodesics in the space of Kellermann.
So in particular, the coherent state transform that we introduced, ALMT, so that is can be understood. It's a generalization of Hall transform, but it was really in the infinite dimensional space. Yes. But still, that can be understood. You are saying.
Yes, if you do for every copy of SLTC, then it's understood exactly in this space.
Thank you.
Okay. Are there any other questions? I have a short one. I was curious about something that you mentioned at the beginning. This Akal program, resurgence and asymptotics. So where would that play a role?
Not here.
Okay.
No, I was just trying to motivate the need to understand better quantization. You know, I'm discussing quantization of systems with finite number of degrees of freedom. Many people would tell me that, you know, we know that for a long time. We don't need. But now you have this ERC looking at different aspects of quantum physics, they just check, for instance, you know, the spectrum of an harmonic oscillator gives you a asymptotic series. It is not a convergent series.
Yeah.
So they have ways of using a Kal resurgent analysis to resum that series and add these instanton corrections and so on, that somehow they find more canonical than before, in which things were done in an ad hoc way.
So this thing would go beyond, for example, Padé analysis and things like that. Okay.
So sorry. Quick. So I mean, since you're talking about this ERS, then the statement is that. Do they have any explicit example in field theory where you've got a perturbation theory which can be, in this sense, regulated and get a finite answer, non-perturbative?
They try to study the standard examples like the harmonic oscillator and so on. Of course, there they don't have many new things, but they...
No, but I mean field theory. Do they have any field theory?
Theory that they are studying, there is a recent paper by Marco Marinho in which he applies this to condensed matter systems. So you have an effective field theory and they managed to solve some problems that were open for decades. That's what they claim.
Okay, so we should go ahead. So let's thank Jose again.